my Gen Next. I'm Manvendra Singh Gohil and you're watching me on Nation Next.
Sir, first of all, welcome to Dialogue at Nation Next.
Thank you.
I would like to ask you first of all that, you know, you're often called the royal poster boy for LGBT rights in India. From a man who did not understand his sexual orientation in the early 90s and thought that he will be normal once he gets married, to being somebody whom the LGBT community looks up to now, how has the journey been so far?
See, for me, the journey has been a journey of going against the current, I would say, because in a country like India, where homosexuality has been a part and parcel of the Indian society, the fact that it's there in our ancient texts and statues of temples, still if the country thinks that it's a Western influence, then it's nothing but hypocrisy. So my journey of fighting with the hypocrites of this country has been very challenging and kind of going against the current. But I believe in one thing, and that is truth always prevails. So truth will always win. It will be bitter, of course, to many people. But my fight is the fight on the basis of truth and honesty. And that has helped me to pave my way and be what I am today.
So talking about, you know, hypocrisy and, you know, talking about some people saying that, you know, homosexuality is an import from the West. You know, Baba Ramdev once said that, you know, I can cure homosexuality through yoga. Or for that matter, VHP Vice President Om Prakash Singhal, he once said that, you know, homosexuality is against the
order of nature,
like So, you know, and, you know, there are people like these who say that, you know, homosexuality is an import from the West that India has brought. So, now, how do you respond to people like that?
See, basically, these I would say that people like Baba Ramdev or Mr. Singhal, with due respect to them, they have a knowledge on the subject in which they are dealing. For example, Baba Ramdev is a great yogi. I admire him for that. But to talk on the subject on which they don't have the knowledge is not right. So I don't blame them, but I blame their ignorance on this subject. And it's duty of people like us to educate them, make them aware that yes, this is the fact. But it's their duty also to accept the truth. See, if you are not accepting the truth, then I think it's no point being a yogi. Because yoga also says satya is the first and foremost step of yoga. Is satya, and if you are not in a position to accept the truth, then I don't think yoga and anything carries any meaning to it, you know. So if people like him who really think that it's a disease, then if you are able to cure a person, if you think that you can cure a person from become from a gay to straight, then I think the other way around is also possible. You know, I mean, that is as simple as that, you know. So I mean, I can also say, okay, if you're straight, I will make you gay. Fine. I mean, if it's so simple, I mean, just by saying it's not going to be possible, because it's an orientation. You're born with that. I mean, I give example to people like him about being left-handed and right-handed. There's nothing wrong in being left-handed. There would be few people who are left-handed, but you cannot you say that left-handedness is a disease and it should be cured. It's your choice. You're born with it. So you have to deal with that situation for your whole life.
Do you think it is because, you know, people cannot really deal with this fact that, you know, that, you know, a straight cannot be, you know, a homosexual or homosexual cannot be a straight. You are born the way you are.
Exactly.
Do you think that they cannot deal with this fact because, you know, ever since, you know, if we go back in the past, India has always been that conservative country and stuff like that. Do you think it is because of that they, you know, they don't want to come out of that moral background that they come from? Do you think it is because of that?
See, I would say, I would blame the Britishers for the downfall of homosexuality in our country. Of course, first it was the influence of Islam and then the Christianity. Otherwise, India has been a very liberal country with regards to not just homosexuality, but for various other issues. You know, I mean, like you see our dressing sense and all, whatever we wear now is all because of the influence of different religions. Otherwise, India was predominantly and is a Hindu country where we are very free and, you know, accepting country. I mean, for that matter, you see about transgenders, how much of freedom we had been given to them, having them in our royal courts. We have evidence of that, and we have the whole Hijra culture here. If you compare it with West, we have the Kama Sutra, which was written even 500 years before Jesus Christ was born, the oldest since sex and encyclopedia, where you say India is conservative, then how did Kama Sutra come up in India? You know?
Obviously. Yeah.
So we have instances of homoerotic form of sculptures in the temples like Khajuraho, which were made even before the Muslims came into India. So when this evidence is there in our, we have characters in the Mahabharata or the even the Ramayana or the ancient texts which have been gay or lesbian. So when we have Ardhanarishwari, for example, you know, so when all this has been existing in our mythology and our history, then it's just the hypocrisy, and it's the when the Section 377, which was formed by the British rule when Queen Victoria was ruling over India, it was that law which actually set downfall towards homosexuality, because British didn't want that or they didn't recognize. Now see UK, they have got Elton John getting married to his husband in the same cathedral where Prince Charles has got married. So it's a complete change. So when Britishers have changed themselves, and now we are not ruled by the Britishers, which means we are not yet free. I don't think we are yet free from the clutches of British, because if India is still to carry on the colonial rules framed by the Britishers, then India is not free. India needs to, if India needs to move forward and go ahead in the development and compete with the other parts of the world, then it has to get rid of these colonial laws which carry no meaning as of today.
When you came out in the open about your sexual orientation, your family disowned you, and at the same time, the homosexuals who could not come out in the open, fearing social backlash, they looked at you, you know, as a role model. So you know, at one hand, that you know, you were a prince and you were disowned, and you know, the entire media was on you. And at the same time, there were people who looked up to you, who wanted to come out in the open, homosexuals. So was that a little bit, you know, very pressurizing for you?
Whosoever went against me, they had that their ignorance on the subject. So when, as and when I educated them, media of course played a very important role. To educate the masses. When I say India, I talk media. I talk about print as well as television media. In the past, especially the vernacular medium newspapers were not very comfortable talking about these issues. Then gradually, they also started talking positive issues, and that brought about a lot of change in the society. So even though there was initial negative reactions from my family side, later on they realize that they are at fault, because the, as I told you, that truth comes out. You know, you cannot hide the truth. It's, it's going to come out one day or the other. So it came out. My invitations to Oprah Winfrey shows and world over have proved that I haven't done anything wrong. I mean, on the contrary, now the especially the members of my royal family are feeling proud of me, that at least there is one royal amongst all of them who has been to Oprah, not once but three times. So it's you know, it's how you change the mindset of the people.
You came from a very conservative and a very traditional background, and you know, you are a prince, and so you were raised that way. You said in an interview that, you know, you were to the villagers, you were the role model. You were, you know, raised that way. Do you think that if a person like you, a prince, could come out in the open and talk about it, anybody can, who you know, who wants to talk about it, who wants to come out in the open, anybody can if you can?
See, I tell my friends, all those friends who want to come out openly and talk about their sexuality, I said first, but there are two things. First of all, become financially independent. Don't depend on your family or anyone else for your financial reasons. Secondly, reduce your attachment to the parents, because most parents are not going to understand these issues. So if these two things are taken care of, I'm sure you know, anyone can come out, because these are the two main factors which kind of deter you, or they kind of discourage you from coming out. Because we Indians are so much attached to parents, and we live in that background where, you know, we want to live with a joint family. So that whole fear of like coming out and then the parents not accepting, and that is so much there, that we tend to kind of, you know, pretend that we are not gay and we want to be in the closet. But the moment you think that you can be independent, you don't have to you should not be subject to getting emotionally blackmailed by your parents. You know, which most parents are doing it, you know. Mm-hmm. They most of the parents I know are literally forcing their children who are gay to get married to a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And that's spoiling everyone's lives.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, nobody is happy in that situation. Mm-hmm. So if the gays realize that, you know, they want to enjoy the freedom,
mm-hmm.
then they have to take a step to come away from that situation where they would be forced by the parents and start living independent and be financially on their own. Then I think there would be a challenge, definitely. It's not that life
Did
is going to be
easy.
Give
them this advice out of your own experiences?
Because of course.
There was
a
time of time in 2002 when you were in depression.
Exactly. So I give my own life experiences. I said, look, I have gone through these things in my life. So if you want to live the life you want to live, then these are the challenges you have to be ready to face, and this is how you have to face it. So if you go ahead with my advice, then you will be a happier person.
You have a royal lineage, and you know you are a prince and a heir apparent to the throne of Rajpipla. You were raised in a traditional way, as we were talking about. You know, ever since you realized about your orientation, there was a lot of backlash from your family.
Yeah.
There were a lot of backlash in the state that you come from.
Who
all were the people who stood by you, no matter what? Who all were the people?
Yeah, so even in the stages of backlash and all, there were few people from my own family. My own grandmother, I would say, who died recently at the age of 90. She was totally supportive of me. So you imagine the older generation people. My own music teacher, my Guruji, who taught me music, who also died at the age of 91. He was a great supporter of me. My secretary, who's still living, he's 93 years old now. He read about me in the newspaper and he said, come what may, if the whole world goes against you, I will stand by you. My father's uncle, who's also in his 80s, you know, he stood by me. So I think the older generation have understood me better than the lower generation. Maybe they have seen more of it. And it's not that homosexuality has not been existing. Homosexuality is everywhere, you know. It's just about you, whether you want to accept it or not. That is your personal choice, you know. And in fact, the Senior Citizens Club of Rajpipla, from where I belong, they actually sent me an invitation to honor me after I came out. They said, we want to honor you. For what? Not because you come out as gay, but because you spoke the truth. And there are many people, not many people in this world who can accept the truth and who can say the truth. So you see, I mean, the people who are not hypocrites are willing to accept you.
But wasn't that the first virtue that people were ever taught in a royal family, that you speak the truth?
Of course. So that is, again, as I'm telling you, we are living in a hypocritical society where you are taught to live, say the truth, and yet we are not able to do it. And that is the biggest challenge one has to face.
The government has a lot of schemes for HIV awareness and prevention of AIDS. Your trust, the Lakshya Trust, it works for the same cause, for the prevention of HIV and for the awareness regarding it. So, do you get any government help regarding the same?
Yeah, definitely. Our project, since the time it started in the year 2001, we have been funded and supported by the government for prevention and awareness amongst the MSM, so men having sex with men community, and the transgender community.
You get help from the government regarding awareness and prevention of HIV. But at the same time, in our country, being a homosexual is not a crime, but getting involved in a homosexual act is a crime. But you cannot get HIV or AIDS in the LGBT community if you are not involved in a homosexual act. But so how do you deal with this double situation that you are stuck into?
Exactly. I mean, it's very strange. Like many foreigners, especially when they come to India, they are confused, you know. They say, is it the same government which is funding you and which is calling you also a criminal? I said, it is in fact a paradox situation. In fact, somebody, media person from Canada, even asked me this question, that when by government supporting you, don't you feel it's an abetment to crime? I mean, they would be, if they are funding you, knowing fully well that you are working for the sexual minority community, then in our country it will be abetment to crime. I said, well, whatever you think, but government is supporting us. I mean, it's for their, of course, benefit, because, I mean, they know for sure that if they have to control HIV in this community, then they have to use us, they have to make use of the organizations like Sarthi or Lakshya or these organizations, which are community-based organizations.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's not possible for them to even enter the community.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, the government has made their decision and we have to abide by it.
Manvendra ji, what are your views on Section 377?
Section 377, according to me, has been widely misinterpreted and kind of, you know, there's a lot of misunderstanding about this section. I would say it is very little about homosexual acts. It's mostly about heterosexual acts,
mm-hmm.
which means that the whole country can be a criminal because this section, if you read the interpretation, it says any kind of sexual act which doesn't result in procreation is against the order of nature and punishable as an offense.
So you cannot really.
Which means that even a masturbation would be an offense. I mean, how many people in this country, you tell me, are those who don't masturbate, whether men or women? That means the whole country is a criminal. So this law is of absurd. It's of no use.
Mm.
It's this law, even the Ministry of Health, a government of India, has stated that this law is an impediment to HIV control in India.
Mm-hmm.
India is already third highest in the world with regards to HIV infections.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to become second highest.
Mm-hmm.
So it's high time this law is amended.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's going to prove a disaster for the whole country.
Mm-hmm.
There will be it's being misused rather than being used.
Mm-hmm.
People are being terrorized. There's a lot of unsafe sex happening.
Mm.
People are not using condoms unnecessarily. People are being emotionally blackmailed and for no rhyme or reason.
Mm.
And it has been total misconception that it is only attacking the homosexual act, which we are just 5% of the population. What about the other 95%?
Mm.
Even if a married woman or and a man are having sex within the four walls of their bedrooms of their home and indulging into sex which doesn't result in procreation, then the both husband and wife would be put in the jail. Now you see where is the question about homosexual act in this? Why do the people just target us? Why don't they target the we are working so that we can protect the heterosexual population as well? We are just 5% of the population. So why doesn't the society understand that situation?
Does your status as a prince and your reputation as a prince and, you know, the India's first gay prince coming out in the open helps you in promoting, promoting what you do, in spreading awareness and, you know, fighting for LGBT rights? Does that help you?
It definitely helps. It definitely helps. See, one thing is that I belong to a very old family. I mean, my dynasty itself is 650 years old, of which we have a recorded history. I mean, you tell me which other family you will know who's beyond your great-grandfather, you know. So I'm proud that I'm born in a family which has got such a rich cultural heritage. We are still looked upon and respected by a lot of people who have been benefited by my forefathers wherever there has development has happened in our part of India. So with that, it definitely I can create a lot of influence on the people, on the society, and my work is a work for the cause. It's a work for charity. It's work for helping people socially, with education, with health, with lot of other things. So people have looked upon me as somebody who is in fact one media interview has quoted me as the people's prince. So I am not working just for myself. I'm working for the humanity, I would say. I don't even call myself a gay rights activist. I call myself as a human rights activist. I work for human beings and I also work for animals. I'm a great animal lover. I work for animal rights also. So I think taking this into account, and of course taking the biggest strength, and that is truth, with me, I'm going ahead and I'm enjoying my work, and at the same time I'm able to help people. So for me, if I can help even one individual, I get a good sleep at night.
Sir, you know, you have come here for the Orange City LGBT Pride March. What do you think that, you know, a taboo subject like this that we're talking about, a pride march is happening in Nagpur, a small town like Nagpur for that. So how do you feel about it and how is it going to help?
See, pride, the word pride itself comes from the word proud, to be proud about it. So the occasions like pride marches and all, these are occasions or events where we celebrate or we express our freedom. That yes, we do exist and we would like the world to know that even though we are a sexual minority, but yet we exist in this planet Earth, and we all have the freedom to love. Nobody can snatch your freedom to love for anyone, so long as you are not harming anyone. I think we all should be given that freedom to love another person and to live the life of dignity and respect. So this events like Pride are a showcase of that. That yeah, we should feel proud of what we are, and we should be given our rights, which have been guaranteed by the Indian Constitution as fundamental rights, and which have been denied to us. So that's all we are asking. We are not asking for any reservation, like you know, you have other people asking for reserved seats and this and that. We just want to live equally, get the live with equality and live with the dignity, like other human beings and other citizens of India are living. So these kind of events are meant for that.
Manvendra, you're a prince, and you know you have been on Oprah Winfrey show 3 times. You are internationally known. The LGBT community in India looks up to you. But you know, in spite of having so much love, so much admiration, you come across as somebody who is very grounded, very down to earth. How do you manage to do that?
Well, I think that's my nature. I have been raised in that manner. I always feel I want to work for the people. And I mean, forgive me for saying this, but there are a lot of people who just do an aerial survey of facts and situations, but they don't want to go down to the earth to see the reality of the people. Though I am born in this kind of family, I have actually gone to experience how a person lives. I have traveled in public transport so that I can experience the pain of traveling in a public transport without getting a reservation. Unless and until you experience that, you will not be able to help a person. So I like doing that because it's my passion, like the God's grace on me, I would say that. And so far so good.
Bollywood has been very open about all these things. Lately, they have been getting very sensitive about the subject. Last year, a movie like Aligarh was released, it was widely appreciated and stuff. Your life story is a very interesting story, and it was reported a long time back that a film is going to be made. Do we see your life story being made into a film?
Yeah, it is in process. It's happening, and there is somebody from the Hollywood who is also taking interest in that. And it would, I mean, I think it's too early for film to be made on my life. I mean, I have hardly done anything in my life, you know. Let some years go by and all, and then maybe something might come up. Which could be like made available for the masses.
You have come here to Nagpur. Nagpur has been special to you. So, you know, your partner comes from there. So, you know, what's going on in your love life right now? Are you, how have you settled down?
No, I haven't settled. I have married my work. I always say, somebody asked me what is your future. I said, till I don't get rights for in India, I'm not even going to think about. A partner, because that is a priority to me, and I don't want to dilute that and get myself diverted, because my full concentration is how I can give rights to my people in India, which have which we are not free.
So love in your life.
So
right,
there's no love, but yes, I would definitely like to seek love, and if people like you and others support us, I think it will help us getting our rights faster. The faster we get the rights, the faster I can find somebody.
It's very hard for a person to come out and you know, to realize their own self if the person whom they are close to, their parents, they are not very supportive of it. So if you were to make an appeal to those parents, what would you say?
I would say, if you really love your child, and I think most parents love their children, then let them enjoy their freedom of what they are, what they are born with. You know, if the child is born with a disability, that doesn't mean that the parent will not love the child. If a child is born with a certain challenge, and it's not justified for the parent not to love the child. Similarly, if the child is born in a manner for no fault of his, then the right approach would be to love the child the way he is, and to give him that freedom, so that if the child is happy, he will make the parent also happy.
Manvendra, thank you so much for talking to us, and I really hope whatever mission that you are on right now, you complete that mission, and you know, God give you all the strength to be on that mission always. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me here.
Thank you so much.